What a good crowd of kids. They got more than we do. The cat's away.
Our scripture for today is John 14:3. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. John 14:3.
Good morning. The choir has gone on strike. The faithful few are here. The ones that are going to heaven are here today. No, Mel's gone, and you know in the Old Testament it says when the cat's away, the mice will play. But it's good to see all of you here today, and we're going to open the service with a good old hymn and going to get the choir to sing with us on the chorus and have a good beginning to our service today.
Oh, they tell me of a home far beyond the sky. Oh, they tell me of a land far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm
cloudless things, oh, the land of an uncloudy sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an uncloudy day.
Ready? Oh.
tell me that he smiles on his children there, and his smile drives their sorrow all away. And they tell me that no tears ever come again in that lovely land of Bunkai.
Sing it with us, everybody.
Oh, the land of boundless days. Oh, the land of an uncloudy sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where the storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an uncloudy sky.
One more time, sing it now.
Oh, the land of cloudless
days.
Oh, the land of an uncloudy sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where the storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an uncloudy day. Oh, they tell me of an uncloudy day.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, keep your mics. Now, pastor's going to come right now. Give him a hand. And you know, there was a time, folks, when he did it all. Some of you can remember. Led the singing. He did it all. And such a talented man.
Amen.
And anyhow, he writes songs once in a while. And this is one he wrote. And we're going to feature him.
Let's start off on the chorus, if we will. And I think it'll be up. I think we can get it there. The title of the little chorus that I wrote, I was sitting at my desk one morning and got to thinking about these words and grabbed my pen and started writing them down and ended up with this little chorus. And it's called The River of Life. And the chorus goes something like this. The river of life is a flowing. The river of life is so free. The river of life is flowing. It's flowing for you and for me. Would you sing that with me this morning as we begin it? The river of life is a flowing. The river of life is so free. The river of life is flowing. It's flowing for you and me. Listen now. The river of life is so pure. It washes my sins away. The river of life is pure. It will wash your sins away. The river of life is a flowing. Come on! The river of life is so free. The river of life is flowing. It's flowing for you and me. The second, the river of life is so pretty. There's nothing on earth to compare. The river of life is so pretty. One day we'll see it there. The river of life is so flowing. Come on! The river of life is so free. The river of life is flowing. It's flowing for you and me. The last one. The river of life is now flowing. Won't you drink and live with me there? The river of life is now flowing. Won't you drink and live with me there? Oh, the river of life is a flowing.
Come on.
The river of life is so free. The river of life is flowing. It's flowing for you and me.
What do you think, huh?
Thank you.
All right, everybody stand and sing with us. Here we go. Everybody sing. Come on, stand up.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace.
In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare us.
Come on now, everybody sing. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victor. Sing it one more time. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing
that will be.
When we all see
Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
All right, you're looking forward to that day? When we see Jesus, we're going to a place called heaven. And there's an old chorus I want us to sing right now. And some of you will know it. The second time we can all sing it. But it goes like this. How beautiful heaven must be.
Heaven.
Sweet home of the happy and free. Fair haven of rest for the weary. How beautiful heaven must be. Just close your eyes and sing it and think about heaven today. How beautiful heaven must be. Let's sing it one more time as Brother Matt comes to lead us in prayer. How beautiful heaven must be.
While we're standing, let's just go ahead and go into prayer this morning. Thank you so much for being here. Had a couple of prayer requests brought before us. Ask that we remember them in prayer. There's a little Rebecca Lloyd. Went to the hospital this week for some tests. Wanted us to remember her in prayer. Pat Grooms is having some procedures. She'd like to have us remember her this coming week in prayer. And little Coy, where is little Coy? She's right over here. She's going to have another procedure. Try to help her son with her seizures. And so we want to keep little Coy also in our prayers. Let's pray together. Our gracious Lord and Savior, Lord, we come before you this morning grateful and thankful that you have prepared a place called heaven, a place, dear God, for all of those who have been willing to submit themselves to you and trust you as their Lord and as their Savior. Father, I would pray now thy blessings upon the service today. Thank you, dear Lord, for your love and your goodness. Thank you for everyone that is here. I pray, dear Lord, that the Holy Spirit will minister to every one of our hearts as we worship you together in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you and thank you. I would ask, you may be seated. I would ask to make the announcement, the men's Bible study will now be on every Friday evening, not Tuesday, but they're moving it to Friday from now on. So please keep that in mind. Thank you so much. And let me just say, it's obvious and everybody knows, let's remember Brother Mel and Miss Annalene in prayer. They're on a little vacation, and they've gone to almost heaven as far as Brother Mel is concerned, and that is Missouri. But it's been so hot out there, it might be like that other place. Let's pray God to give them a wonderful rest. And thank God for Brother Buddy and doing a great job and filling in for us this morning. Thank you.
Amen. All right, we're going to sing another song about heaven. I don't know. I know we're not going to do that. We're going to welcome the visitors.
Why don't you do that?
Yes. There you go.
Thank you.
How many would just like to get a visitor's card?
I want a pen.
Yeah, you get a free pen.
One thing I did forget. Thank you, Brother Buddy. Let me just butt in here. The principal down at the elementary school here in Gibsonton called a couple of weeks ago and asked for some help. And I told her that we would certainly respond and
help in any way that we possibly could. They need supplies for a lot of the children. There are 600 kids, 600 just here in the elementary school in Gibsonton. And many of them live in very low financial family needs. And so a lot of times the teachers have to buy pencils, paper, to help them. And so they said, could you help us? And I said, yes, we will. So next Sunday, if you during the week would pick up some school supplies and bring them next Sunday morning, have a place out in the lobby for you to leave everything, then during the week we will get them to the school. We've already bought, I don't know, close to 5,000 pencils that she said they probably will use 6,000 pencils during the year. And we've already bought about 5,000 pencils for the school. And so anything else that you can help and contribute to, it'll be a help and a blessing and a good testimony for our church as trying to help the needs of people and especially children in our community. Thank you for what you do.
Speak up a little bit. Yeah, if you holler.
Okay. Thank you.
Isn't it encouraging to know they're still teaching them to write? Not cursive. God forbid that they be able to write a letter to somebody today. I see that hand. Yes. Okay. Where's he going? Where are we?
Pardon me?
Where'll it be? Yes, Greg's going in for surgery tomorrow, and it's good to have Peggy Kennedy back again
yes.
today. This ceiling's liable to fall in. And we need to remember Brother Cook. He's going through cancer treatments, and they killed it on one side, and it came up on the other. Sound like a song, don't it? But we're believing if they can kill it on one side, then kill it on the other one. Dean? Right? All right. How many of you remember, if you've been saved, when you were saved? Anybody remember? How many of you remember, like in revivals, when you would rededicate your life and God would bless you in different services like that?
Yes, yes.
Well, this song talks about that. Heaven came down and glory filled our souls, didn't it? Yes, sir. All right, that's what we're going to sing. I'll let you remain seated if you sing good. If you don't, we'll stand up. All right, here we go.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I wandered in darkness away, Jesus my Savior.
Think about that.
Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling, with joy I am telling, he made, you remember that? All the darkness departed. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down.
We're going to sing the chorus one more time, and I want you to sing it like you believe it and feel it and sensed it in those times. Ready?
Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down, and glory filled my soul.
tonight. We've had some good singing and praying today, and I'm praying that in the message today that heaven will come down and glory will fill our soul before we leave this place. There used to be a chorus we'd sing. Don't leave here like you came, in Jesus' name. Now, if you came in here with your problems and all, and you think about those, you'll leave worse than you came in here. But if you'll get that off your mind and think about the Lord and listen to the songs and get into the service, it says enter into his presence. He's just not going to come out and jump down and bless you because you're sitting on the fifth pew. We have to enter into his presence and make an effort to worship and enter into it. So we hope today heaven will come down and glory will fill your soul. Right now, Edwin's coming to sing for us. Always a blessing, young man.
Morning, church. Today I'm going to be singing a song called Please Forgive Me. My sleep is gone, my heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe how much I've let you down. I dread the pain that waits for me tomorrow. When the sun reveals my broken dreams scattered on the ground.
Amen.
Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you until my dying day. Help others find the way. I'm at your mercy. Please forgive me. I can't believe the God of earth and glory would take the time to care for one like me. But I read in the Bible that old story.
Amen.
How he pled for my forgiveness when he was dying on the tree. So please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. At your mercy, Lord, I'll serve you until my dying day. Help others find the way. At your mercy.
Amen. Amen. Well, we might have church here today. We keep at it, amen. I'm telling you, it's sounding good. Sounding good, and it's feeling good too, amen. Good to see everyone. Thank you so much all for coming and being here today. A lot of folks are away. It's that time of year that people get that little itch to travel. And so we do have a lot of travelers and in our church. But good to see you. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here this morning in the services. This morning I'd like to speak on the most important doctrine in the Bible. Of all of the doctrines, I could begin to name so many of the great and wonderful doctrines of the Scriptures. I could talk about the premillennial turn of the Lord. We could talk about baptism. One of your favorite subjects I could preach. I know I get more shouts when I preach on tithing. Great doctrines of the Bible we could all preach on. But all kidding aside, the greatest doctrine in the Word of God is the doctrine of grace. Over in the book of Romans, chapter number 5, what is grace? Well, it has been described as the unmerited favor, unearned, undeserved, unmerited favor of God on mankind. Could I say it's the very foundation of all that we believe? It's the foundation of salvation. The Bible said, for by grace are we saved through faith. So it's a wonderful doctrine. I'm afraid maybe we don't spend enough time thinking about the wonderful merits of salvation. Let me read about 3 or 4 verses in Romans chapter 5, verses 15 through verse number 17. Here he said, not as the offense also is the free gift, for if though the offense of one, many died, or many be dead. They're talking about Adam. Adam, one man sinned. And every one of us become sinners. You say, well, why am I held accountable for what Adam did? Because we were born into this world after the seed of Adam. Every one of us. And Adam died. And we suffer in sin. But he said, much more the grace of God and the gift of by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ. So one man, Adam, caused all of the problems that we live in today in this world. Adam, as you know, and Eve in the Garden of Eden, sin came upon all mankind by one man. God sent His Son, Jesus, and by one man, Jesus, God made a way for all to be saved, for all to be brought out from under the curse that one man, Adam, put us all into. Isn't that a wonderful God that made a way for us to get out from under that, because we had nothing to do with it? Some of you are old enough to have been to Adam. I don't know. Some of you look like you might have been there, Garden of Eden, but one man cast this whole world into sin. But God said, I'll send my Son Jesus. One man. If one man could cast the world into sin, God said, my only begotten Son can redeem the world, one. And no other can redeem man's sins and set man free. By one man, Jesus Christ has abound unto many. I hope you're one of the many. And not as it was by one that sin, so is the gift for the judgment was by one too. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which received abundance of grace and of the gift of the righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. As I was reading those scriptures, a word kept sticking out at me. In those three or four verses, five times connected with the word grace is the word gift. Think about that. So grace is a gift from God. It's a gift. The Bible said, for by grace are we saved through faith, not of ourselves. It is a gift. A gift is something that is absolutely given to someone with no strings attached, free. If I paid one penny for a $1 million item, it really would not technically be a gift. I'd be glad to do that if anybody wants to do it. But once any effort is made on our part to earn, it's no longer a gift. Salvation is a gift. It is a gift from God because of the grace of God. So this morning we're sitting here and enjoying the wonderful worship of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ because of the wonderful gift, the grace of God. As I said in the opening, there is no greater doctrine in the Word of God than the doctrine of grace. So we think about grace this morning. The blessings of grace. I could go on and on and on, but I will not. And everybody said amen. Grace. Grace appears often in different ways in our life. Grace appears in the times of trials and troubles for the child of God. When God saved us, He did not take away all of our troubles. He did not take away all of our trials. That's yet future. We live in a world that's a terrible, dark world because of the curse. We live in a world today that everywhere you turn, there's evil. There's heartaches. Hospitals are full of those who are suffering and pain, even this morning. Even the saved often suffer just like the unsaved. But we find that grace in a time of trouble, there's something enduring about the grace of God. Grace, knowing that you're saved. The grace of God when trials come, and we all experience them. Every family, every person, every man, every woman, we all have our trials. We all have our troubles in life. Thank God a day will come, we'll leave all that behind. But as we live upon this old sin-cursed earth, we have our trials. We have our troubles. Sin has made this world a very trying place to live for God. Boy, I don't know about you, but even though I'm saved, I find sometimes the struggles of trying to live for the Lord in this old sin-cursed world that you and I live in. But I'm so thankful to know that the grace of God is always sufficient for every trial, for every heartache, every problem of life, no matter what we may find ourselves entering into. The Apostle Paul, the great apostle, think about this. This great apostle of Paul, of God, Paul, he suffered. And over in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 9, God sent Paul a message that every one of us need to endure to our hearts. Paul was suffering. We don't know all the details, and you know, it's not necessary to know all the details about how someone else is suffering. You just need to pray for them. Paul had some great problem. Oh, there's a lot of speculation, but that's not important. Paul had his trials. He had his troubles, and he prayed. Oh, God, please remove this from me. The Bible said he prayed three times. God, have mercy upon me and take this away from me. Paul felt like he probably could better serve the Lord if he didn't have that trial, that trouble that he was experiencing in his body. But God said no. He told Paul in 2 Corinthians 12, 9, he said unto me, my grace, let that word grace sink in this morning. I don't know if we can fully comprehend the depth of the grace of God. I just know it's always there when I need it. I just know that God, by his grace, sustains us and keeps us going. Even though we live in an old world of sin, the grace of God keeps me living for God. And Paul prayed and God said, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Boy, sometimes God allows problems, sickness, all sorts of things to come into our life that just breaks our heart. And we always say, dear God, why? I was thinking about that as I wrote down the message. And I said, you know, God has a plan. And God's working his plan. Let that sink in. I don't understand all about the plan of God. I don't understand why God lets certain people suffer like they do. They're good people. Christians. They love the Lord, but they have cancer. Thinking about Brother Larry Cox. His dear wife just had cancer surgery, and both of them are in physically, and they're good people. Larry's preached and they've sung the gospel. And you say to yourself, why in heaven's name would God let good people suffer? Paul probably said, God, I'm your man and I'm your apostle. Why are you letting me suffer? But God has a plan. And God works his plan. And through our suffering and through our trials, we can let the world see what the grace of God empowers us to be. You see, as a child of God, empowered by the Holy Spirit of God, we can, even in the midst of adversities, praise the Lord. When the world will curse and rage and get mad and say, where's God? We humbly say, dear God, we're in your hands. We're in your hands. And Paul, after God has spoken to him, he had prayed three times and begged God. And God didn't have, because God had a plan. And God is working his plan. I don't know why good people, like I just mentioned, are suffering. I don't know why the beautiful and sweet and wonderful wife God gave me is suffering. But God has a plan. And in that plan that I don't understand, I don't know the depths of it, but God knows all about it. In the midst of that plan gives you and I the opportunity to demonstrate to the lost world the grace of God. We don't get mad at God. We don't get, oh, got it, and curse God. No. We humble ourselves and ask God for strength. Ask God to help us through our trials. And as a child of God, we do our best for divine help. No matter what we're going through, God said, I'll never leave you. God said, I'll never forsake you. So I know that when I go through my troubles and you go through yours, that God is right there with me. And God is right there with you. Because of the grace of God. Paul said, God said to Paul, my grace, could I say to you, as I say to myself, the grace of God is sufficient for all things. God has a plan. Think about John the Baptist. A godly man. He baptized the Lord Jesus Christ. A good man, a godly man. They cut his head off. God had a plan. We think about Peter. Well, Peter became a great apostle, great leader in the church. They crucified him on a cross upside down. Most all of the other disciples died a martyr's death. Now, what about Stephen? One of the first deacons in the church. A good man. A godly man. They stoned him to death. You say, preacher, why? Because God has a plan. It's a plan that is much above us. A plan that only God can see from beginning to end. Nothing is going to happen tomorrow that God does not already know about. God is in absolute total control. But in the midst of all the trials and troubles, I have an opportunity and you have an opportunity to let the world see what the grace of God can do in the life of a child of God. We can do all things through Christ, who strengthens us. So grace. Grace in the time of trials and troubles. Grace to have victory. Now I know y'all don't have a problem with this, but I do. Temptation. Thank God for the grace of God. Grace does not shield us from temptation. Are you listening? But grace enables us to overcome temptation. I'm not looking at a person here today that's old enough to know anything that is not tempted. We all are. To say we're not is being deceptive, not only to ourselves and lying to others. Temptation. The Bible says Jesus was tempted in all manners as you and I. But he never one time sinned. And by the grace of God, we can overcome temptation. You live in this world and you're alive some way, somehow, many different ways, God, you're going to try to be tempted. But by the grace of God, we don't have to yield. We can receive power from on high that keeps us from yielding. All of that is God's gift to me and you. If I let, and it, I'm going to include you too because I don't want to take all the blame. But if we turned our flesh loose this morning, and it wasn't for the power of the grace of God to keep our lives under control, think about what would be going on in your life, in all of our lives. Temptation is there, everywhere. But by the grace of God, Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, God is faithful. Boy, you can underline that in your Bible. Let me repeat that because you might not have heard it. The Bible said God is faithful. He's faithful and he will not suffer, that means permit, you to be tempted above or beyond that ye are able to withstand. That means every time that you and I are tempted, that God's grace will enable us to be victorious over the temptation. Hallelujah. Bible said, but he'll make a way to escape. A lot could be said about the word escape, but I won't spend a lot of time on it, but it's almost like you run from something. If you escape, you break out of prison, you run. Some of you done that. You get in trouble, you want to escape, you run. Brother, when temptation comes, the best thing to do is run from it. Because you're going to, all of us, almost every day of our life, we will have to deal with temptation. There's an old song we sing, yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. Thank God for the grace, the power of the grace of God that keeps us. If you want that scripture that I think I quoted already, Hebrews 4:15, Christ was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. You see, we don't have to sin because we're tempted if we'll flee. Because of the grace of God. He made a way of escape. That's grace. My flesh did not make a way of escape. But God made a way of escape for every one of us. Every time the devil tempts us with something, every time the flesh is allured by something we see or hear, God makes a way of escape. So if we don't escape, it's not God's fault, it's our fault. Because he made the way to get out. He made the way to get free from that temptation. So the blessings of grace. I close with this additional thought. The blessings of grace. Grace enables one to make the transition. Are you listening? The transition from earth to heaven. Hallelujah. Without grace, gravity is going to keep you here. Somebody say amen. Boy, grace is more powerful than gravity. Think about it. And grace will enable us to make that transition from earth to heaven. Doctors with good meds can sometimes make us live longer, but they can't give us eternal life. Only God can do that. I'd rather have eternal life than temporary life. Doctors can help us. Thank God we get sick. We all go because we want to live. But I know this, I'm going to live forever. And if you're saved today, by the grace of God, you're going to make that transition. That transition from earth to heaven. God will one day take us by the hand and lead us out of this old world of despair and hopelessness. I love 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It is known by all as the resurrection chapter of the Bible. I'll only read a verse. Verse number 53. This corruptible must. See, you can't make the transition with corruptible. You're going to leave this old flesh, these old fleshly desires, ways behind. By the grace of God. Said this corruptible must put on incorruption. And this mortal must put on immortality. Then will be brought to pass the saying. Death is swallowed up in victory. You see, we were dead in our trespasses and sin. Until by grace God came into our life through His Son, Jesus Christ. So I was a dead man, and so were you, until one day God pumped into me eternal life. And He said, you shall never die. Grace. Oh, preacher, you must have been a pretty good guy. No, I wish. You don't need to know. No. And I don't need to know about you. Because you know what? We were all a bunch of sinners. Dirty, nasty, ugly in the sight of God. Sinners. God knew everything about us, and He still saved us. He still loved us. Grace. By the grace of God, one day the trumpet's going to sound. By the grace of God, one day, gravity will lose its hold, and the dead in Christ will begin to rise. Can you imagine? The dead in Christ shall rise. And we shall forever be with the Lord in heaven. Grace. Outside of the grace of God, we'd die in our sins. Some people say, well, preacher, what can I do? The rich man asked that question, what can I do to be saved? And the answer is absolutely, you can do nothing. But you can believe. You can believe upon the name of the Son of God. And trust Him as your Lord and Savior. and thou shalt be saved. The moment you say, God, here's my wallet, I'm going to give you my, I'd throw it, but Buddy would get it. And Lord, here's everything I got. I want to go to heaven. God said, it's a gift. You can't pay. You can't. I don't accept anything. Amen. I don't accept your good works. Nothing else. All I'll accept is you're a humble spirit. Praying and asking my son Jesus to come into your heart and life and forgive you of your sin. I'll give you eternal life. That's grace. So if you're here this morning somehow thinking that heaven is your home because you have gone to church most of your life, maybe you give good offerings. I don't know. You think somehow all of that is going to get you an entrance into heaven? The answer is none of it will. None of it. For by grace are we saved through faith. That not of ourselves, it's a gift. It's a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. I'm saved and you're saved today by the grace of God. I can't brag on myself, but I can brag on Jesus. Because he did it. He did it all. Would you stand with me? If you're here this morning, maybe you've never truly been saved. Maybe you, depending upon, you know you're a good person and you try to live right. Be a good man, good woman, good teenager, all of that. You kind of think that's pleases. It does please God, but it won't loosen you from this earth to heaven. So I say to you this morning, if you're not sure you know the Lord, if you're not sure of your salvation, you need to be here at these altars and let us pray with you, help you to understand from the scriptures how to be saved. Maybe there's Christians here today that, boy, you've had a tough week with temptation. Had a tough time with temptation. You need to say, dear God, this morning, help me to escape the temptation that I'm going through. Help me to do right. Help me to be the man, the woman, dear God, that be pleasing in thy sight. We give that invitation this morning. These old altars are always open for those who want to come and pray. If you're here this morning and you want to become a part of this wonderful church, this is the time to come and receive you into this church. Let's sing. Arthur, this morning, they're going to come. Come right on, folks. Amen. Brother Rogers, God bless you all. I'm so thrilled that God has sent you here. I really am. And it's not an accident. God had a plan. And he's working out that wonderful plan. And we love you. And I want to do my best to be a good pastor for you. Thank you so much. Father, I thank you for this fine couple, Lord, that thou hast sent here to this church. Lord, I just pray that, Lord, we'll be a blessing to them as they are a blessing already to us. Lord, use them mightily and greatly here. And Lord, just put your hand upon them and bless them. May their spiritual lives continue to be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless y'all. Y'all just sit right here. Are there others this morning want to come and pray? We're going to sing another stanza. Let's continue to sing. God bless you. Are there others? All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. Thank you so much. Thank you. You may be seated. We have coming this morning Brother and Sister Rogers and Maya, they've been coming and visiting here with us now for, over a month or so. And God has just led them to become a part of First Baptist Church Gibsonton. So let me introduce to you David and Susan Rogers. And they come this morning wanting to unite with our church by statement. I think that's the way y'all, and they've already followed the Lord in believers' baptism and know the Lord as their Savior. Is that right?
Amen.
Amen. Would you, with me this morning, warmly welcome them into First Baptist Church Gibsonton? They asked me once, they said, what do we have to do? I said, well, we keep it pretty simple around here. And this is about all that there is to it. Now just be faithful. And help us to build a great church. And together we can do it. God bless you all. Thank you. After the service, make them welcome. Would you do that? Yes. Make them welcome. Y'all may be seated. Our ushers. Okay. He says you already have, but continue to do so. Ushers, would you please come? Praise the Lord. We had a teenager saved at camp a couple of weeks ago, and if everything falls together next Sunday morning, she'll be baptized. So we thank the Lord for all that He's doing here in our church. Continue to see God blessing us. Thank you for your offering. Thank you for all that you do. Father, we're grateful for this service this morning. We're grateful for the grace of God. By your grace, we're able to live Lord, such a wonderful life here in this great and wonderful country. Pray you bless now as we give and honor you with all that you have blessed us with. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. As we're receiving the offering, one of our new and favorites around here, Miss Edie, going to come and sing for us. Listen as she sings.
Thank you. Morning, church. I spoke with Iris Cox Saturday, and she asked for all your blessings on Larry and them. And I told her many churches are getting the call that God's saying, I'm coming soon, I'm at the door. She said, even so, come quickly. This is one of Iris' songs. I changed the format, and I hope that you love it as much as I do. One of Iris' songs. Can you hear the Father calling, longing for some time to spend with you? He sees every time you shed a tear. He knows the trials you are going through. You don't have to face this world alone. He is waiting for you patiently. Listen.
Listen closely and you'll hear as he whispers in your ear. Beloved, come away with me. Beloved, come away with me. How I long to hold you in my arms. When you're there, I know you'll see. I'll be your shelter from the storm. I want to walk and talk with you. Show you wondrous things you've never known. I have always loved you so, and I'll never let you go. Beloved, come away with me. Have the pressures of your daily life made you feel that God is far away? Have you let the time just come and go? And you haven't taken time to pray. Do not let another day go by without reaching for the Father's hand. He will gladly come to you, still calling out to you. Beloved, come away with me. Beloved, come away with me.